Hello, everyone, and thank you for joining us today. I wanted to kick off today's panels by expressing our most sincere gratitude to all of you for your partnerships over the years. All of you have played such a critical role in the history and the success of our company. Throughout the long history of our company in the toy and game business, we've relied upon innovators to bring us concepts like Mr. Potato Head, Monopoly, Transformers, Beyblade, Furby, Pie Face, and the list goes on and on, example after example of innovators and inventors bringing us these incredible ideas. So thank you for that. Today, we'll share the stories behind some of the most famous and the most successful inventor concepts that have helped grow Hasbro into the company you know us as today. We are so extremely appreciative of all the inventor contributions to the Hasbro portfolio that have helped us put smiles on the faces of billions of children over the years. So please join us today as we celebrate some great new innovations. We want to make sure that we continue to partner with you and build partnerships for our future success together. Thank you very much. And with that, we'll begin with our first panel.
Greetings, everyone. My name is Tanya Thompson, and I'm the head of Global Product Acquisition and Inventor Relations for Hasbro Gaming. Basically, that means I'm the one that connects with innovators and creators from around the world looking for Hasbro's next big game idea. I'm so excited to moderate this Chi Tech panel today about JENGA, and I can't think of two better people to do this with. First of all, Leslie Scott, who is the inventor of JENGA, and Jeff Anderson, who is the GM of Hasbro Gaming. So welcome to you both.
Thank you.
Leslie, first, let's start with you. The game of JENGA has transcended family game nights and become a cultural icon across the globe. So tell us, you know, port us back to the beginning. What was the spark that created the idea for JENGA?
That's quite difficult to answer. There were really a series of sparks. But I'll take you to Africa at the beginning, if I may, because that's where I was born and that's where I was raised, mostly in East Africa. So I was born in Tanzania and then in Uganda and in Kenya, and I spent most of my childhood there. But in my late teens and early 20s, I spent a few years in Ghana on the west coast of Africa. And Ghana, while we were there, my much younger brother, who was about five at the time, and I was just about 18, had a set of building blocks, you know, children's building blocks that were offcuts from a sawmill in Ghana. And as a family, we always played games. I mean, we turned things into games. It was just something. I have four siblings altogether, and our lives was forever. And I think we were just horribly competitive, is probably the truth. We sort of turned everything became a game. You know, who could jump the furthest, who could do this and all the rest of it. So we were playing. We were playing with these blocks. My younger brother claims that we took over his blocks, and we were playing these blocks, and a game evolved. So that was spark number one. But I didn't really sort of pick up on that. I mean, that this was an idea for a game that should be marketed. For sure, I didn't think about that at the time. But I had a couple of sets made, and that were for me and for my and the other members of my family. And I brought one of these sets with me to England when I came to live in Oxford. And every time I went anywhere, I was invited to come, you know, bring your box of bricks with you. So I'd sort of turn up, and I mean, I got to the point where I assumed they actually wanted my game, not me, for a dinner party or whatever it was. And it kind of just sort of, I mean, it slowly dawned, and the sort of second spark, if you like, came when I was watching one day some very good friends of mine who are professional real tennis players. So they were serious sports people, absolutely engrossed in this game. I mean, they wanted to win it. They wanted to win, and they also wanted to play it again and again and again. And there was like sort of I would say it was more like a penny dropping than the spark. You know, so it was like, why don't I turn this into a game and put it on the market? There were several sparks, I suppose, to answer your question.
Yeah, no, that's good. That's really good. It's fascinating to hear that you're both kind of where you lived, which was in Africa at the time and grew up, as well as the involvement of your family, like happening upon this incredible game as a fun pastime, evolved into what we know as Jenga today. And the fact that the roots come from your kind of upbringing in Africa is amazing. So tell me, you know, what were there any early challenges that you had that you faced when you went to sell this to people? Because you like obviously decided, okay, I'm going to try and make this a game. Mm-hmm. And so what was the story right when you first decided and kind of took it to market, as you will?
Well, there were endless challenges, but all of which I didn't foresee the challenges. I think it was partly, partly my age. You sort of think that you can do anything.
That's a good thing.
Yeah. So I had absolutely no idea of what I was getting myself into. And then the first challenge was actually how to actually turn a handmade box of bricks into a product that could be sort of manufactured in quantity. I was very lucky to be introduced to some people up in Yorkshire at a place called Camp Hill, where they had a workshop and they were already making toys. And I sort of asked them, would they be able to sort of produce these blocks for me? The immediate reaction was, sure, but if this becomes a huge success, you're going to have to go elsewhere because there's a limit to how much we want to sort of swamp this very sweet workshop with just blocks. But
yep.
And then the next challenge was, of course, that I actually had to launch it, and I had a deadline for that, which was the toy fair in London in 1983. So that's sort of end of January, February.
Yep.
And I was pretty convinced that this game was just going to just sell overnight. You know, it was going to, I would go to the toy fair and I'd have a success on my hands. And to that end, I thought I've got to have quite a lot of product ready and waiting. So I asked the Camp Hill whether they could make me enough blocks for 500 games. And if you still think about it, there are 54 blocks in a set of Jenga.
Yep.
And
27,000.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So I was trying to work it out. So 27,000 games, 27,000 blocks descended on my house. I mean, they arrived under my house in living in Oxford. I was living in a one up, one down, small sitting room, which was filled with these blocks, which I then packaged myself. And I came up with this idea for this packaging, which was I wanted the blocks to be seen, so you could see what it was that you were buying. So I got this. But apart from that, I mean, aside from that, the fact that that was actually sort of the thought process, so you could actually sort of see the thing. I went for the cheapest possible packaging you could go for, which was this sort of transparent sort of plastic sheath, if you like. And actually, I'm looking here because I've got that.
Oh, wow. The
game. That's the original. The game.
Yeah.
I packed this game myself. That is probably the only game, actually, in its original packaging, in the world. Actually, maybe one other. I'm not sure. But so I sat there. For weeks, packing 500 games ready for this fantastic. This fantastic launch of the game that I was going to, you know, that was going to make me millions overnight. And I turned up at the toy fair and I didn't sell a single set of Jenga. So to, wow. so to further, what were the problems along the way was that I was a one person business, a totally new business, certainly a new business totally, but new to the toy industry for sure. I had one product that was unknown.
Yep.
And I had no budget for promoting this. So at this fair, people would come by and they would play the game and enjoy it, and, you know, fell over onto a glass table that I had, and there was, of course, quite a lot of excitement. But I didn't write one single order, because no retail outlet could actually write orders for something without any backup to this game. Nobody was going to take it. So that was a pretty steep learning curve for me. It's to realize that actually that is a huge challenge.
Yeah. Yeah, well, thank goodness you persevered, Leslie, because it's just been such a huge success that Jeff and I are definitely honored to be a part of. Well, moving over to you, Jeff, since 2012, Hasbro Gaming has done like more than 30 different versions of JENGA. So obviously a huge success for us. What's your personal favorite, and what qualities do you think make JENGA ripe for innovation?
Thanks, Tanya. Great question. Obviously, you know, it's wonderful hearing the story from Leslie about how it all really came to be and the passion that she's got for it. And I think that really comes through in all the different expressions that we have of JENGA. I think despite all of that, my favorite's always going to just be the classic ones. It's such a simple game. It offers incredible depth of gameplay, from the collaborating and building the tower itself to that special tactile feel of the wood blocks that she talked about. The mounting suspense of watching the other players pull out those blocks and the anticipation of your turn and trying to decide what the next move is going to be. And I think in a lot of ways, I think all of us would agree that the best part is when that tower finally falls over and you hear that iconic JENGA sound, right? That crash. She talked about hitting the glass table, right? It's just that wonderful noise that we really just relate to. And I think it's those same qualities that really make JENGA ripe for innovation, right? It's how do we take this wonderful experience, that true brand essence, and move it out. At Hasbro, we talk about that as really the DNA of the game itself. So when we look at the DNA of JENGA, what is that? It's really about the building and the construction, the anticipation, the strategy, and then that suspense of not sureing if the tower is going to fall all the way or not. So in the new versions that we look at, what we really do is we challenge ourselves and the teams to think about these core qualities. How can we push them further to express them in the new games, while at the same time really being honest to Leslie's original idea? So I think we're super excited about what we've done in the last 30 versions, but we look forward to the next 30 as well.
Yeah. I love hearing from your perspective, talking about the DNA of JENGA. It's so important. So if you, Jeff, if you're looking at the shifting game landscape, especially in the environment we're in right now with COVID rampant around the world, what does it mean for games like JENGA, and how do you think about evolving them in the future?
Yeah, it's obviously a big impact to the business. The games business at Hasbro has seen significant growth since the start of the pandemic, as people really are sheltered in place at home, spending time with their friends and their loved ones. I think it's served to remind us about the true role of what games play in people's lives. The games are special, right? I think anybody who's a game fan knows that there's just something unique about the games experience that really transcends other kinds of entertainment. It's about a couple of key things. For us, we talk about the ability for people to connect over a game, to share a moment in time and an experience together. And those things then transcend into what we think of the most important, which is that games allow us to make memories. And that as the steward of this iconic brand of JENGA, or all the brands that we have at Hasbro, we want to evolve them in that lens, right? How do we keep that purpose of making memories the sole focus of what we do? And I think during this outbreak of the pandemic, we've seen more than ever before the heartfelt space that games play in our lives. Mm-hmm. So we feel that obligation. And so what we talk about extending them and evolving them into the future, it's the ways that we want to look at new gameplay patterns and the twists that we want to bring to the consumers that they already love and really help them experience it in a different way, right? So what is it that we're going to do to bring it into the family game night, or to hang out with some friends, as she said when she was at Oxford? That those are the things that we want to do and really enable those long-term memories between friends and family.
Yeah, absolutely. Having raised 3 kids on games, and I can definitely agree with like that connection. And now it's more important than ever as we try and find connection with other people in this different environment. So yeah, thanks for that. Leslie, you know, there's a lot probably because there's so many people that know about JENGA. We probably feel we know it inside and out. But is there anything that we as consumers even are not aware of that you'd like to kind of share?
Yes, I think there's one very specific thing, and this goes back to sort of the origin of the game being based on this handmade blocks of wood. I mean, one of the most difficult things about turning that into a mass-produced game is that you're taking something that was handmade, and I mean the sort of process of making a mass-produced thing that has that handmadeness, if you like, is challenging. So because what you have to introduce is that each one of these blocks have to be different from each other, very very slightly, but randomly different. And I think when people realize that, certainly in my experience, if I've ever said to somebody, do you realize that this game that you've got here of JENGA is not the same? I mean, it's unique. I mean, that particular game is unique from any other set of JENGA out there, because the randomness has been built into the mass production of the game. So you have... We put into it this idea that it could have been handmade. I mean, they obviously are not any longer handmade, and I think that is a fact that I think a lot of people don't grasp, is that, I mean, if you sort of know it instinctively, because if you look at, or intuitively rather, if you look at a game of JENGA when you've set it up, you can actually see that there's ones that are already loose. And then you remove that, and then you take that already loose one out. And if you take that block and you put that particular block, that specific block on top, that block has an effect on the whole tower in a way that no other block would have an effect, because no other block would be that precise size and weight, I think is also part of the key. And that's why the fact that it's wood is essential to the game, in my opinion. It's certainly essential to the classic game, I think that does actually sort of, if you think of the millions of games that are out there, the idea that no one game, no one set of JENGA is identical to another set of JENGA, I think it's quite, that tends to sort of get people thinking if they haven't thought about it before.
Yeah, that's fascinating. I never put a lot of thought before into, you know, when you play and you kind of start tapping around the tower to find out where's the loosest and therefore best strategic, you know, block to take out and put at the top, that it actually has to come down to the fact that it's manufactured in wood. And that means there's these slight imperfections that make games, each game unique. So I love that kind of way of looking at it. As JENGA has kind of evolved over the years, or grown and spread to so many over the years, I see a lot of different either consumers or organizations using JENGA in a fun and different way. Mm-hmm. So I was wondering if you've seen anything recently that's inspired you out there in the world.
I have. I think the thing that I would calls to mind immediately is coming across an article that showed that MIT were training robots to play JENGA.
Yep.
And they were doing this because, I mean, it's an incredibly complex thing, actually, being able to tap it gently enough so that the whole thing doesn't fall over, but actually figure out a loose one and then grab it, in the human terms, then you put it on top. I don't think they've actually got a robot yet to do that, I don't know. There was something incredibly exciting for me to find that something that is so not technical has been used by something so technical, and the physics and everything else that goes into that is. It's so complex, and I think that's probably one of the most exciting things that I've come across recently in how JENGA's been used.
Yeah, that is really interesting, especially you think of it as just such a simple action. You're playing a game, but there's actually a lot of thinking in the decisions one makes and how they play. So, it's interesting that, we're helping robots, take over the world maybe, but it's really, I'm sure it's super cool for you when you see something that you created kind of now being used in all these intelligent and different ways. So
it's extremely exciting. I love it.
Yeah.
I really love that. But I also love anytime I see like a small child playing it and going, whoa, like this. I never would get tired of seeing other people's reactions to it. I love it.
Yeah, that's true. And I've even seen dogs and cats videos online playing it. So, Leslie, you've reached all corners of the world. Different.
Just don't ask the challenge to play a dog. Yeah. I would hate to be beaten by a dog. I would rather play a robot.
Yeah, I could see that for sure. Well, thank you so much, Leslie, and thank you, Jeff, for sharing such great, background stories and fun facts about JENGA. It's really interesting to hear about not only its history and where it came from, but also as Hasbro takes it into the future, what the thinking is around it. So it's such a beloved brand around the world, and it's an honor. It's been an absolute honor to moderate this panel for Chi Tag with the two of you. So thank you.
Thank you, Tanya.
Thank you much indeed.
Hi, my name is Rich Mazel, Hasbro's Senior Director of Product Acquisition. Welcome to the Hasbro Innovation Panel, where we tell the story behind the story of some of Hasbro's iconic brands. And there's none bigger than the Nerf brand. I'd like to intro the panelists that I have here. First of all, you can't have a new concept without an inventor. And we work with outside inventors all the time. So I'd like to introduce you to Reyn. He's an inventor and serial entrepreneur. And amongst other things, he invented the Nerf ball. Hi, Reyn. How are you?
Good, Rich. I'm well, thanks.
Thanks for being with us. I see some snow in your background there.
My pleasure, as always, to be with you.
Wonderful. And then we've got some VIPs from the Nerf team. So we have Tom Warner. He's Senior Vice President and General Manager of Nerf and Sports Action for Hasbro. Hey, Tom.
Hey, Rich. How you doing?
Good. Thanks for being here.
Yeah,
and then we also have Brian Jarvis, who's Senior Director of Product Design for Nerf. And you've been on there for more than a decade, right, Brian?
That's correct.
That's awesome. All right, well, let's jump right into it, Reyn. So take us back to the Nerf ball. So I think we're talking about maybe 1970, but tell us the story behind it, how you came up with it, how you pitched it, if you could.
1968.
68, okay.
Yeah, that's what my recollection got to today. 1968, I was 14. And we were doing some team testing on a group that we called Windsor Concepts. And I had formed that after I had the success with Twister. So we were trying to test a really bad game. And it was a caveman style. We were walking around on paper that looked like stones on the floor. And the guy who was developing the game cut out some foam from packing foam. And they were black foam, and they were calling them rocks. And we tried to throw the rocks at each other if the other person was trying to reach under a rock that had some of your money in it. And that's how good a game it was. It was a lot of fun. Anyway, in a break, one of the guys started tossing one of these little chunks around and bouncing it over a net, and everything stopped from then on. And we just said, time out, that's it. All of us went to our desks, started cutting out little pieces of foam that we could find with our scissors. Soon thereafter, discovered that there already was technology that allowed hot wire to cut out little round balls of foam. And that's what we took to answer one of your questions, Rich. Was it turned down? Yep. Our buddy
rejected. Please don't tell the person's name, because it's always my greatest fear that you turn down something like the Nerf ball. So it has been rejected.
Milton Bradley, who had done so well with Twister, turned it down because they didn't feel they were in they were in the game business and not the toy business. And we went then to Henry Simmons, who was head of Parker Brothers. The Parker Brothers acquisitions. And he said, well, tell you what we'll do. We'll put one ball in a box and see if we can sell it. And that we had walked in there with about at least 8 to 10 new ideas that we could do with indoor ball play at that point in time. And when Henry called and said, well, I think we're just going to put it in the box and put it out on shelf for a dollar, I think, at that point. We were disappointed, falsely so.
That's amazing. A reminder to keep it simple. So it started off as a game, but then you guys recognized that the real play pattern was sort of just a fun indoor ball. And I guess the rest is history. Now, Tom, you run the group now. What's it like when you're put in charge of this mega brand? And how did we get there from foam being cut up out of like packing foam to where we are today?
Well, first I want to thank you for sharing that fantastic story. You know, that's pretty amazing to think of. That is where Nerf started and where it is today. You know, when I got asked to run the Nerf business, it's obviously super exciting, but it's also a little nerve-wracking when you go on to take on a brand that has so much nostalgia like Nerf and so much love from people around the world. You know, it really resonates with people from every age, from young to people who grew up with the original Nerf.
Absolutely.
Was created, and we just heard that great story. So what I just love about it is when you say Nerf, and I tell people that I joined in leading up Nerf, it just brings a smile to people's faces. And everyone has a story about their favorite Nerf product or a funny scenario they were playing with a Nerf product. And I think that is so cool. You know, personally, I grew up with the Nerf football and basketball. I was a child of the 70s, and man, I had so many fond memories of backyard pickup games. And wearing out my Nerf football to a point where it actually ripped in half, you know?
I remember that, yes.
They buy my next one. And it's really fun now being a parent and seeing my kids play with Nerf. And, of course, we have the football and basketball and such, but it's for them, it's all about the Nerf blasters. And they love that. And we have a great time with it. So, you know, I think for me, what we're going to be doing with Nerf is really – taking it to the next level. And that's why I was brought on board, was really how do we continue to drive Nerf forward and really expand this brand like we never had in the past. So I'm super excited to take on that challenge.
Well, I'd say you've been doing a great job, because the brand has never been more popular, and it's everywhere. It's on social media. You're right. It's kind of across all age categories and income levels. It's pretty amazing. So over to Brian. Brian, you've been with the brand for over a decade. You got any fun stories of developing items, or what's been your favorite times with Nerf?
Well, the Nerf brand, you know, Rich, I've been with Hasbro a very long time, and it's one of my favorite brands that I've ever worked on. I've had the opportunity to touch a lot of different brands, but the Nerf is something special because, as Tom was saying, I grew up with these items, the round ball, the football, and going on from there. So I think, you know, one of my favorite stories is when I was, when my kids were small, we were big fans of the Super Soaker, which is also under the Nerf brand. And I was sitting on the back deck having a nice cold beverage, and my kids were running around squirting me. And I said, boy, I really don't want to get up. It'd be great if I just had something I could attach to my hose. And that led to the development of the Super Soaker Flood Fire, which had a quick release. Hose, and then it would also charge the blaster. So if I wanted to release it and run after them, the blaster was fully charged at all times. So it's things like that, just a connection with my kids And being working on the Nerf brand, if I walk into my kid's school for a show and tell, kids literally ask me for autographs. And I have done show and tells with my wife in when she teaches in the schools, and it is amazing how everyone loves and knows this brand.
I think it's the only time my kids thought my job was cool when they got to meet Dude Perfect at HasCon or whatever. They're like, "Dad's job is cool." They didn't really realize it before then. So yeah, Nerf brings everyone together. So Reyn, I always tell inventors about you because it's super rare for an inventor to have a household name in their portfolio. A lot of items come and go, but not only Nerf, you also invented Twister, a Hasbro classic for decades, and you have award-winning music records. What's your secret to success over multiple industries and multiple decades?
Quite frankly, I've gotten lucky, just plain old lucky. The accidents that led to some of them are longer stories than I think we have time for today, but they have led to and led me. But I do think a couple things are useful for me. I know that I'm not ever the smartest dude in the room, but I love working with teams. And anything I've ever done that has been successful and worked has been with teams. And Rich, you and I have chatted many times about, what kind of teams do you want? And I've always said that I'll take 2, 3, 4, or 5, and we can make teams out of it. And but any more than 5, and you've got a committee. And you ain't going to get anything out of that committee.
Remember you saying that? And I've used that line many times.
So I do believe in teams. The other things that have worked for me are, honestly, I have encouraged all my teams to use the 3 magic words, what happens if? And I always encourage everybody to use those words. What happens if? Not what if. What if leads to, it starts off nursery rhymes and stories. But what happens if we bring the product out now? What happens if we're not ready to do this? What happens if? Ask the questions of what are the steps built in there. And I honestly, it sounds stupid, but those 3 words have been very helpful to a lot of our teams. Another thing that has been a byword for me is if in a meeting with a team, you think you've got something and you think maybe it might work, do not do anything else, but go straight to whatever you need to do to make one. Do it. Make one.
Prototype it, yes.
The times that we often, I know everybody has done it, have passed by an idea that, oh, damn, somebody else did that. We talk ourselves out of it because we get so analytical. Once the idea, oh, that's not going to work because... You know, it probably isn't going to work, but oftentimes it leads to the work that you do in building one or making one, often leads to a spinoff or something new and different you haven't seen before. So every time we have gone directly to, or I've been a part of going directly to making one, it has oftentimes led to something, and I still go by that byword. The other thing is maybe, even at my gentle age, I still think like a kid.
Oh, I love that. Love that. Good tips. And this is a little bit of an aside, but you did bring up luck in your history. And I do know that Twister was due to be shelved, basically. And it ended up on Johnny Carson, and Johnny Carson played it with Zsa Zsa Gabor, which was a lucky turn for you, a lucky turn for Hasbro as well, too. So luck sure does play a lot in this.
Amen.
Tom, I've got a question for you. So I was a child of the 80s watching reruns of Brady Bunch, and I always remember the one, "Don't play ball in the house." Mom said, "Don't play ball in the house." It kept going over their heads over and over again. And I believe they broke a vase. So the rule was, you can't play ball in the house. Nerf kind of said, "Oh yeah, now you can." Is that still part of the DNA of Nerf?
I love that you brought this up, Rich, because it is very much the part of our DNA. We have a saying in the team at Nerf, it's do the impossible. And we should never question, like, the word "I can't." It's how do we make it happen? And how do we solve a problem that, again, comes from consumer insights that kids are struggling with? How do we allow kids to play football at night? We create a glow-in-the-dark football. How do we get a blaster to shoot 120 feet? The amazing product team comes up with Ultra. So we're constantly challenging ourselves. How do we push ourselves and do the unexpected and solve a problem that our kids want us to solve, to allow them to play in ways they never thought possible?
That's great. I love it. Child empowerment. So with that, Tom, where do you see Nerf expanding into the future?
Well, I think it's really an exciting time for the brand. You know, I think there's a couple key areas for us. One, obviously, is the amazing design team we have, who are leading with innovation. And we're going to continue to push ourselves and always be that leader in innovation in the blaster category. But we kind of talked about this earlier. Nerf is such a strong brand. We will expand it outside and take it into new areas. Obviously, we've had great success with Super Soaker, and that's an area we want to continue to build out, and sports is another. But we're also taking it into new areas like location-based entertainment. Oh. Who opened up a massive Nerf center.
That looks amazing.
Yeah, Nerf Action Experience in Singapore that's doing phenomenally well. You know, obviously COVID's thrown a little slowdown in that, but yep. You know, it really allows kids to experience the full brand of Nerf and play Nerf in a massive, fun way. We've also taken Nerf into the video game world. We partnered with Hama, who's a very successful mobile game company, and we launched Nerf Epic Pranks, which really brings the fun of Nerf to the mobile video game space and allows kids and parents and fans of all ages to play Nerf on their phones. And everyone has that predisposition of how to play Nerf, and now they get to do it on their phones. And I see video games as another great area for us. We have some other really exciting initiatives. I can't tell you.
But, stay tuned.
Yeah, stay tuned. You'll be hearing a lot more. But I think we're really at just the beginnings to unlock what the full potential is of Nerf. And I'm super excited where we're taking it.
That's awesome. Not a bad place to be from something that started off as a marginal game about throwing some rocks around the house. So, Reyn, it sounds like we need to go to Singapore as soon as COVID's done. So let's put that on the calendar.
Amen,
for sure.
Rich. I haven't seen you in quite a while, but it's nice seeing your face.
Yeah, nice to see you too. And thanks everybody. Reyn, amazing. If anybody wants to learn more about Reyn Geyer, reyngeyer.com has all his background and the background on Twister and Nerf if you want to learn more. Thanks to Brian and Tom for bringing the insights from the Nerf group. And and thanks for being a friend, Reyn. I appreciate it.
Tom and Brian, nice to see you too.
Yeah,
keep it going, boys.
Yeah, all right.
Enjoy it.
Take care. Thanks, everybody.
Happy day, guys.
Hello, everyone. I'm Rich Mazel, Senior Director of Product Acquisition for Hasbro. And we're back with another great innovation panel highlighting our great brands that have come from outside Inventors. Today, we'll be talking about the iconic item that became a brand, the iconic Furby. First, I'd like to intro our great panelists today. First off, we have Brian Chapman. He's President of Design and Development for Hasbro. Hi, Brian. Thanks for being with us.
Thanks, Rich.
And how long have you been at Hasbro?
Oh, a long time. I don't
know. Okay. All right.
But enough to work on Furby, so.
Well, you still look young, so that's good. And then we have Kim Boyd. She's Senior Vice President and General Manager of several of our iconic brands at Hasbro, including Furby. So, hi, Kim. How are you?
Good. Thanks, Rich.
Thanks for being here. Then we have Richard Levy. He's an entrepreneur, ad executive, former TV producer, and the man who licensed Furby. Welcome, Richard.
Thank you. Good to be here.
I was going to say that you were also identified as a Russian spy on ABC News in the 90s. Is that correct?
That is correct. You can see it on YouTube.
That's a whole other story. So thanks for being here, Richard. We have another Richard today, too. So three Richards. We have Richard Maddox. He was a former Hasbro director and animatronic expert. So Richard Maddox, how you doing?
Hello, Rich. Good to see you. Doing just fine. Thank you.
Good to see you as well. So my first question is to Richard Levy. So how did you first become aware of Furby and a part of all this? I know David Hampton and Caleb Chung were the inventors. And how did this how did you come into play?
Well, I had done a favor for an executive at Mattel many years prior. I helped his wife, who lived in the Pacific Northwest, bring a product to market. And when it was all over, he asked me what he owed me, because I spent so much time on it. And I said, you know something, you don't owe me anything. Just consider it a favor and pay it forward. I left on very good terms. And Caleb Chung and Dave Hampton were working at Mattel, and they needed some help with this character called Furby. David Hampton put the name Furby on it. And I guess spoke to this executive who said, you know, there's this toy and game inventor in Washington who might be helpful to you. Give him a call. And I got a call, and that's how I got involved, by just doing a good deed for someone.
Wow, it's a good karma.
But the interesting part of the story is, they had gone to two companies prior and struck out. And they told me which the companies were. It doesn't really matter. And they said, where do you think we should go? What do you think we should do? And I said, Tiger Electronics. I said, because they're very entrepreneurial, and I had an excellent relationship with Roger Schiffman.
All right.
So I called Roger and I said, Roger, where are you? And he says, I'm in LA. And I said, terrific. I said, I want you to meet these two chaps. That chaps for you, Richard. To see this character called Furby. And he said, okay, I'll do it. And he was at a hotel in LA for some conference or something. And what happened was, he called me the day before the meeting and he said to me, can't do it. He can't do what? And he's hecking into a handkerchief. I could see him. He's sick. He said, I'm really come down with something serious. I'm going back to Chicago. I was supposed to go on to Hong Kong, but it's not going to happen. And I have to cancel the meeting. And I said, well, you can't cancel the meeting. He said, no, I have to cancel the meeting. I said, well, can we do it in Chicago? And he said, no, because there's a million reasons why. And I said, okay, Roger, here's the bottom line. I said, how many years have I known you? And he said, 30 years. I said, have I ever wasted your time? He said, you've never wasted my time. I said, are you on your deathbed? I mean, how sick are you? And he goes, well, not on my deathbed. I said, okay, Roger, do this one for me. See the guys. And he goes, I'll do it. And the rest is history. I got a phone call after the meeting at the hotel. And he came to the door, evidently, in like boxer shorts with a handkerchief, sneezing, whatever it was. You know, he was serious. He wasn't kidding around. And then he called me up afterwards. He says, you know, and this was a dream. This wasn't a finished product. He said, you know, you're really onto something here. He says, what do you want to do next? I said, let's meet in Chicago and let's lay it all out on the table. You put it on the table, which we did. And there's a lot more to the story, but I don't want to.
That's great, though. That's a great part of the toy world. So you got karma, and also, you know, sticking to your guns as well, too.
Well,
so
sometimes you have to know when to play that card. And I had the relationship. You know, the only person who got torqued off by the whole thing was the person in charge of inventor relations, that I didn't go through the system.
They can be difficult people.
Well, I couldn't the system, because I couldn't afford to put this into somebody else's hands.
Too big, yeah. That's great. Now, Richard, back to Richard Maddox. You were there at Toy Fair, so fast forward. So obviously, this became a thing, and it was unveiled in 1998 at Toy Fair. Can you tell me a little bit about what the reception was like at Toy Fair, and were there any hurdles to getting Furby ready for prime time?
Well, could I just backtrack a little bit to your the same question you asked, Richard. So there I was doing my freelance inventing. I was in the middle, and Richard Levy called me up and said, and I quote, "A friend of mine's got a problem with a mechanism. Can you come and take a look?" I said, "Well, I'm in the middle of a really urgent project right now. My 10-year-old son was having International Day on the following day, and I was in the middle of building a red phone box replica, you know, a phone box."
Yeah, yeah.
Long story. So I said, "Look, I've got to do this." So Richard said, "Okay, as soon as you can, come round." Well, it was about 11 o'clock at night, wasn't it, Richard? I came round.
Yep.
And now normally, you know, people have boxes.
We live 20 minutes apart.
Yeah. Normally people have big cardboard boxes. He had this little box. And he said, "Take a look in there." So I opened up the lid and thought, "What's this?" It was about this big. And he said, "Well, can you take it away? And it needs some improvements to get it running." Well, I had a look inside it and it frightened the life out of me. I'd never seen anything like it. There were more gears, motors, sensors inside this little thing than I'd ever seen before. So I went back, cleared the bench, started taking this apart, and there were pieces everywhere, you know, and spent the weekend, as I remember it, Richard, getting it running a bit more smoothly, had a different gearing in, and it was basically, the design was brilliant. It was one motor operating four animatronic functions and all these sensors everywhere. So
that became patented, right? That was the secret sauce inside there.
Yes, that's another story, but yeah, that's right.
Yeah,
it was basically a single motor and four cams. We can get into that if you want in a bit, but 1, 2, 3, 4 cams and one motor. Instead of four motors and four cams, the price was right. The chip was in there. Dave Hampton sourced this chip that would do the job. And, how much detail you'd like, this could go on for a long time, but Richard, you put together a team, didn't you, in BC?
And by the way, mathematics was so critical in the mechanism, I can't overstate it.
Richard's always humble, and that's what I've heard.
Remember calling him once at like 2 o'clock in the morning. I said, "Richard, you got to get on a plane to Hong Kong." Do you remember that?
Oh, yes. Yeah.
You got to go.
No, this period of time, starting that night, it was really 7 days a week, or 16 hours a day, wasn't it? Just working round the clock to get this. The toy fair was only 2 weeks away, wasn't it? And a commercial, promotional video shoot was in Canada somewhere. We got one of the models working, and I remember he disappeared through the door at sort of midnight to catch a plane to Canada. Where was it? Montreal, I think.
Toronto.
Were two or three more models left. I thought, poor fellow, whoever would want to do that, little knowing that 2 days later, I would be one of those people doing the same thing with another model. One at a time,
The commitment to Furby by Tiger was incredible. We can get into that. It's a long story. But Hasbro was the white knight. Hasbro came in after Toy Fair when they acquired Tiger Electronics. And we couldn't get rapid prototyping done. And I had gone all over the country.
Yes.
And I said to Randy Rissman, I said, "Randy, we need rapid prototyping." He says, "Listen, do you know Al Varecchia at Hasbro?"
Of course.
He said, "Give me 20 minutes." And by the way, Randy Rissman never didn't pick up a telephone when I called during the development. He was the president of the chairman of Tiger. I called Al Varecchia and I said, "Hi, Al." He says, "Randy says you need something. What is it?" And I said, "I need rapid prototyping desperately." And he goes, "Give me 20 minutes. And then call," was Charlie Kayberry?
Charlie Kayberry,
He says, "Then call Charlie Kayberry." So I called Charlie. He says, "Al said I should do whatever you need. What is it?" I said, "Well, we need X, Y, and Z." He said, "Come to Pawtucket and explain exactly." I said, no, please come to Washington. Let me do it here because Richard was there and whatever. And they had just acquired Kenner, and Kenner had prototyping. And that saved the day. I remember seeing Alan Hassenfeld the night that Furby came out, and he was crazy for it, absolutely crazy. And he says to me at the party downstairs, he said, "Hey, so what do you have new?" And I said, "Furby." And he goes, "You're Furby?" And I said, "Well, what are you doing at this party?" And I said, "Well, you invited me." He goes, "Get to Hong Kong." Yeah, it was a great marriage. So everything worked.
Very positive reviews from the trade and all of that at that first Toy Fair, huh?
It was not to be believed. I'll tell you something. There was a point in 1998 where KB Toys, it should rest in peace, KB Toys had an open purchase order for 25,000 Furbies a week until further notice.
Whoa.
And in 1999, according to Roger, for the 6 weeks leading up to Christmas, 24/7, Furby sold one unit worldwide every minute.
That's amazing.
So that first time span between the October, you know, and Toy Fair, 4 million Furbies.
Well, there's a big jump there, isn't it? Because the prototype was brilliant, but we had to design it before we got to Hasbro, and then there was Peter from England and a whole bunch of us. And Peter was working on the drawing board, and then when Charlie Cabry and Dave Albarni came down, they said, "Where's the database?" And this is 1998, remember?
I said, "That's right.
Database? What's a database?" We had engineering drawings, so we then found somewhere that actually actually put into CAD all of Peter's drawings, and then those were the files then that went, well, once we built the first one using the rapid prototyping, and we got together with the R&D at Hasbro, which was brilliant. One of the big things that made the difference is Bob Felice was an instrument maker before he joined the toy business. You know, we all come from different walks of life.
Right.
Well, I don't know how much you can see of this, but...
Is that one of the original prototypes, by the way, Richard?
Where are there some at Hasbro? I've got a couple of bits.
I know Dave Hampton has a couple.
Yeah.
That's I've cool. got a couple of pieces in a box. Yes, but nothing working anymore.
So you took it from prototype to actual manufacturing, which is a big step.
Yeah, huge step. Yeah.
And Brian, Brian Chapman, you've been around for a long time, so you've overseen multiple iterations of Furby. You got any good stories from one of these times? I'm sure you got a lot.
Oh, yeah. I mean, like, Furby is so meaningful to Hasbro because not only is it probably the biggest single item, if you look at all the expressions that we've done, you know, over the years that Hasbro's ever done, it really put us into a whole different category, right? So it really taught us how to do interactive animatronic creatures.
Right.
And that, you know, that was just so powerful for transforming our company. So really... the purchase, the acquisition of Tiger Electronics, Richard and Richard, your contributions with Furby not only made immediate success on that item, but has just really allowed us to do things completely differently over the years. And look at how it's evolved and continues to evolve.
That's great.
Every year. So, yeah, the funny story I have is, you know, and, you know, I came with that Kenner acquisition. So, you know, I was around when all this was going on. We had a lot of problems with our engineers and designers traveling with Furby, right? Because it was this crazy, you know, electronic creature that kind of had a mind of its own. And, you know, people were getting stopped in the airports. They were saying, you can't travel with that. So we had to really think about how we, you know, implemented a new policy. And so much so that the NSA thought it was such a security threat that they banned it. Right. And they thought it could
record this.
Yeah. Classified information.
By the way, I used to travel with it like out to California. You may have forgotten this. This was the time of the Unabomber.
Yeah.
And I got stopped at SFO thinking they didn't know what this thing was. They see all these wires and things.
Yeah. So Furby's always had a mind of its own, and it's always brought that kind of that you know, intelligence that
is
mind-blowing. So, yeah.
I must tell you a story, an inside story, inside baseball kind of thing that you all, I don't know if the general audience will understand, but, of course, salesmen want to get products out immediately. And there's always this tug of war between sales and R&D. Is it ready?
Yes. Yep.
So one day, Roger Schiffman came over to me and he said, "Release the code." I said, "Can't do that yet. You know how many orders we have? Release the code." And he said, I said, "We can't." He says, "Why?" I mean, you may remember this, RJM. He said, I said, "The cam is off a little bit and the eyes aren't connecting with the consumer, if you will, with the child. It's staring at the child's belt."
Gotcha.
And he looked at me, and this is a classic line from salespeople. He said, "Will I sell one more Furby if I allow you the extra time?" And I looked at him and I said, "Yes." And he went, take the time. And it was two more weeks, and then David released the code.
Gotcha. Yeah.
Because so the whole thing was right. Connected with the eyes.
Absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely.
And that made That's a huge awesome. Difference.
Yep.
So, so just a quick question for everybody. Oh, yeah, there you go. A quick question for everybody. So Furby's gotten a lot of press over the years, but I'm a huge Simpsons fan. And in 1999, the Simpsons did a spoof of Furby. It was called, the episode was called Grift of the Magi. Does anybody remember what they called the toy in the show? Because they didn't call it Furby. Maybe they didn't want to get sued. It was called Funzo.
Is that what?
Yeah, and they played up one of the features. And the question I have for maybe Richard Maddox is, one of the features that was played up in that Simpsons episode and was talked about a lot is that there was no on and off switch. So and that was very controversial at the time. Was that a design choice? Was that purposeful on your part? And Richard, you can both answer.
Yeah. Well, so this was definitely a design. It was Dave Hampton, because of the artificial intelligence, the fact that it had sensors, and if you stopped interacting with it, it would go to sleep and turn itself off. He insisted it doesn't need an on-off switch. And that did cause quite a stir, didn't it, Richard?
Yeah, no, you're right. It was a tug of war at the time, because that was a big bone of, I don't know, big bone of contention, but, you know, do we have it? Don't we have it? I will tell you this. If we weren't at Tiger, if we were at Hasbro or Mattel or, you know, whatever, somebody would have said, no, put the switch. Mm. But we won the battle on many battles at Tiger because they kind of let us do what we had to do. And this was Dave's dream of not to have it. He wanted it to come alive.
Right. Absolutely. Come alive. Yeah. Not with a switch. Yeah.
Now, you guys were brilliant in one of the generations where it came alive, but you let it have
The sleep mask.
Sleep because people had trouble putting it to sleep.
Yeah, because I think on the Simpsons, the finale was that the parents got so upset with it, they put it in a pile and I think burned them or something like that, because they couldn't turn these things off.
Have you seen the Furby organ?
Yes, the Furby organ is great.
It's cool.
People that haven't seen it, go to YouTube. It's fantastic, and lots of arts installations with
how about the MIT Media Lab with the 400 Furby eyes in the wall?
That was awesome. That was awesome.
I met her.
That's very cool.
The artist.
Now, question for Kim. So now you've been entrusted with many of our brands, and now you've been entrusted with Furby. What's this meant for you, and where do you see Furby going into the future?
Well, I mean, obviously, just judging by this conversation, it's pretty exciting. You know, Furby's consistently been at the forefront of innovation in the toy aisle. And what's been incredible is how much it's evolved over time. As new generations of kids come in, Furby somehow, through innovation, continues to evolve as well, you know, with new technology, really to give it that mind of its own. I can't necessarily speak to the future of the brand or any specifics, but I would say that, you know, it's always been powered by innovation, and I think it's going to be incredible to see where that's going to lead us in the future.
That's great. And speaking of that, Richard, we need the next Furby too. So feel free to bring us the next big thing too.
I will tell you one other thing, and this has to do with Hasbro's global footprint. I travel all over the world, as those of you who know me know well. And I wear Furby T-shirts, not because I don't say I'm part of Furby, but just to see if people recognize it. And the most amazing thing was we were broken down in a truck going into Bolivia from Chile up in the Andes, and the whole road was blocked. And I had a Furby T-shirt on, and I got out of it. And a truck driver from Bolivia said to me, "Oye, mira, I'm in la camiseta de Furby." They know it everywhere. There's That's nowhere awesome. In the world. Yeah.
It has global appeal.
Yeah, with a very positive spin on it.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
You guys have been amazing.
All right. Well, thank you all for being here on this panel and giving us a behind-the-scenes look into the world of Furby and your continued support of Outside Inventors. So thank you all.
Thank you all.
Great,
for
thanks.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Bye.
Thank you to the Hasbro team and to the talented innovators for coming together and sharing the stories behind these successes. In a word, wow. A special thank you to Mary Cousin and Chi Tag for giving us a platform to share these stories. And to all the inventors watching, we are eager to partner with you on the items that will write the next chapter for Hasbro's great innovations. Thank you.